So this video is designed to demonstrate the ABR testing strategy as defined by the British Society of Audiology, ABR testing in newborns recommended procedure, which was published in 2025. The particular focus on certain changes that have been made compared with the previous version. It's not the intention that this video replaces the full recommended procedure document, and clinicians should be encouraged to refer to that document for the full detailed guidance from the BSA. We will be using the Interacoustics Eclipse device for the testing shown in this video, and it's important to be aware that if you are using other equipment, the values referred to in this video may not apply in the same way. So we have a baby who has kindly volunteered to be our testing subject for the purposes of this video. As always, first things first is to prepare the skin and place the electrodes on the baby's head. As the Eclipse is a two-channel system, we will be using four electrodes. And once these are placed in the right areas and the electro cables have been connected, it is important to check the impedances. These should be below 5 kilo-ohms, but also evenly balanced. So we're looking for ideally no more than a 1 kilo-ohm difference between your electrode impedances. Okay, mister. You're looking a little bit this way. There you are. Hi, Papa. Hi. Oh, I know it's cold. Oh, I know. I'm sorry. Shh, shh, shh. Oh, darling. I know. Oh, Papa. Good boy. There we go. There we go. There we go. Yeah. That's quite nice, isn't it? There we go. Do one just off here. There we go. Oh, you're so sweet. I know it's cold. I know. Fast asleep. Totally not bothered. Lovely stuff. Job. I'll go for the left ear next. You are good as gold, aren't you? Oh, yeah. Oh, I know that one's funny, isn't it? It's okay. It's okay. Yeah. There we are. Oh, Baba. Shh, 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 shh. Hold on, hold on, hold on. Shh, shh, shh. There, there, there. Good job. Good job, mister. Oh, very good. Shh. Oh, yes, that's it. Turn over. You turn over that way, I can get you out of here. It's okay. Shh. Good job. Good job. There we go. Just need to get in under here. I know, that one's the worst. Oh, it's okay. I need to get to that ear though. There we go. Oh, thank you. That's the stuff. There we go. Oh, Papa, you're okay.
We're still friends. We're still friends. Thank you. Thank you. Good job. Oh, well done. Shh, shh, shh. There you go. Okay. Oh, thank you. I'm gonna put this one on here. Yes, yes. I'll do that one there. This is okay. You're gonna feel this one. Here we go. Oh, it's okay. We're not doing it again. Shh. Can I get in here? That is one tightly closed shoulder. Oh, there. Shh, shh, shh. Good boy. Oh, so good boy. Yes, you are. Yes, you are. Thank you so much. You superstar. Shh, shh, shh. Here we go. Big stretch. Big stretch. Yes. Oh, I know. What are all these things? There you go. Shh. Oh, good job.
So now we are ready to start testing. Inset earphones are in, and we're going to be testing the right ear first using a 4 kHz narrowband CE chirp. We're going to start testing at 10 dB above discharge level, which is 35 dB NHL for this patient. Now, the 2025 BSA guidance encourages a two-stage process. The first of these two stages is a first look initial phase. This is designed to help you more quickly establish roughly where threshold is. The goal here is not to establish clear response versus response absent, nor is it to record waveforms that can be labeled as such. If a response is present, it is still recommended to label wave 5 and SN10 for peer review purposes. During this initial phase, averaging should continue until the residual noise reaches double the required value of an RA waveform. This value will vary depending on the equipment and software version that you are using. So in this case, we refer to the Eclipse values for software versions later than 4.4.2. The residual noise level required for an RA is 15 nanovolts. Therefore, in our first look initial phase of testing, we will average until we reach twice this, 30 nanovolts. This is the recommendation for when there is no visible response within the waveform. If the waveform appears to be a clear response, then you do not need to keep averaging until you reach 30 nanovolts of residual noise. You can instead stop testing earlier when the FMP value is met. The first waveform shows a good morphology with a large amplitude, and the FMP criteria has been met at 600 sweeps, with a residual noise level of 36 nanovolts. However, the BSA guidance recommends that a minimum of 1,000 sweeps should be tested, so I did not stop averaging at this point. As there was a strong possibility that this waveform could contribute to our final threshold or gold standard, and the averaged waveform was still varying in morphology, it was decided to continue testing for longer. At 1400 sweeps, the waveform morphology had settled down and wasn't changing as much with every packet of 100 sweeps tested, so the recording was stopped. From here, I decreased the level by 10 dB down to 25 dB NHL, which corrects to 30 dB EHL for this baby, which is our discharge criteria. Testing at 25 dB NHL did elicit another waveform with the expected morphology. It follows the anticipated latency shift and amplitude reduction compared with the level above. The FMP value has also been achieved. As this is the level of our discharge criteria, a repeat waveform was run next. We can see repeatability in the second waveform compared with the first. And although there is some noise between the two waveforms, this does meet the 3-to-1 signal-to-noise ratio criteria required to categorize this level as a CR. The amplitudes are both over 40 nanovolts, and the FMP was met as well, adding further confidence to our interpretation. As the first waveform at 35 dB NHL had an FMP value of greater than 2.2 and an amplitude over 100 nanovolts, there's no requirement to repeat this in order to satisfy gold standard. In this instance, an unreplicated CR waveform is acceptable, but only for the level above threshold. Repetition is still required at threshold. And as discharge level has been achieved on this right-hand side, there is no need to test at a level below 25 dB NHL in order to satisfy gold standard. So, onto the left side. Once again, testing was started at 35 dB NHL, which is 10 dB above discharge criteria, for the 4 kHz narrowband CE chirp stimulus. As this first waveform on the left was running, it became apparent that there was no discernible wave 5 morphology. Once again, we can see the initial phase of testing in action here. Rather than establish a complete response absent, which would require 15 nanovolts of noise, of residual noise, to be achieved, I'm able to stop testing at 30 nanovolts of noise and move on to seek threshold more quickly. In this case, we are below 30 nanovolts at 800 sweeps, so testing continues until 1,000 sweeps are obtained. Here, testing is stopped at a residual noise level of 23 nanovolts, still higher than is required for a threshold-defining response absent. There is no need to repeat this level, as we are not threshold-defining at this point. Instead, the BSA guidance advises to increase by 20 dB for the next level to be tested. So our next level is being tested at 55 dB. Once again, using our initial phase principles, there is no discernible wave 5, so testing is stopped after we reach the combination of 1,000 sweeps and below 30 nanovolts of residual noise. Although the guidance advises to increase by 20 dB, this would take our testing level to 75 dB, which according to the masking calculator would potentially cross over to the better ear and therefore require masking. In order to avoid this, I opted to test at 65 dB instead. At a level of 65, the FMP criteria was met at 1,100 sweeps. But because the morphology was quite weak in this instance, I decided to continue averaging for longer. A robust morphology did emerge, and testing was stopped at 2,500 sweeps. At this point, the initial phase has allowed me to roughly establish that threshold is likely to be around this 65 dB level. This is where we can move on to the second stage of testing, the precision phase. In this phase, we will focus on establishing threshold accurately and with repeatability in order to satisfy the definition of CR and RA, preferably with gold standard met as well. To this end, a repeat of 65 was tested. There was some noise between the waveforms, therefore four traces were recorded in total, with waves 1 and 3 added together, and then waves 2 and 4 added together.
The recommendation from the BSA is to use the merge waveforms functionality rather than the add waveforms functionality. Adding the waveforms leaves the original waveforms visible and generates a new added waveform. However, this can leave your screen unnecessarily cluttered when only the added waveforms are needed for interpretation. By merging the waveforms, the final merged waveforms are displayed on the screen and the original waveforms are no longer displayed. These can be viewed later by simply unmerging the final waveform if needed.
The end result was a set of repeated waveforms which satisfied the 3-to-1 signal-to-noise ratio requirement and definition of CR. The next step of testing was to focus more on the level of 55. We have recorded one waveform here during the initial phase, however, the residual noise of this waveform is too high to contribute to a true response absent. However, it might be possible to use this waveform if we need to run more than two traces. The first waveform could be combined with our third waveform and elicit a residual noise that does satisfy RA criteria. Our two new waveforms do not satisfy RA criteria, therefore an additional waveform was run, giving us four waveforms at 55 in total. By combining the first and third and second and fourth, we have achieved residual noise levels in the combined waveforms of 13 and 12 nanovolts, below the 15 nanovolts required to satisfy RA criteria. Unfortunately, despite these low residual noise levels, there was still too much noise between the two final waveforms to meet RA, and so the level of 55 had to be categorized as inconclusive. Although the presence of this inconclusive waveform at 55 meant that gold standard could not be achieved for this frequency, there is still value to running an ABR at a level above the CR that we have obtained at 65. I decided to test at a level of 70 dB NHL in order to minimize the likelihood of cross-hearing, which could then wake the baby up, and he was growing quite unsettled at this point during the test. So the masking calculator does advise that 70 dB NHL should have masking applied to the opposite ear. However, with a clear response established at 65, the level of 70 was not going to be contributing to threshold determination. Once again, we can accept the unreplicated level of 70 as a clear response because it isn't contributing to threshold determination and has an amplitude that is greater than 100 nanovolts and an FMP over 2.2. At the end of this ABR test, we have met discharge criteria with a result of less than or equals to 30 dB EHL on the right side at 4K, and on the left side we have a result of less than or equals to 70 dB EHL. Further testing should aim to resolve the inconclusive waveforms at 55 dB NHL on the left, and obviously continue on to perform bone conduction testing in order to establish the nature of the hearing loss on the left-hand side. As we have seen in this video, the 2025 version of the BSA ABR guidance provides opportunities for more efficient testing strategy, which allows us to roughly establish where threshold is more quickly. From there, we can then focus our time and energy on testing more precisely around those threshold levels.